Okay, could I ask members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible? And the final item of business is the members' business debate on motion 2957 in the name of Gillian Martin on Marie Curie's Great Daffodil Appeal 2022. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I invite members who wish to participate to press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Gillian Martin to open the debate for around 7 minutes, Ms. Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to lead this year's members' debate to highlight the work of Marie Curie and to draw well-deserved attention to the Marie Curie Great Daffodil Appeal of 2022. And like so many charities and services, Marie Curie has been impacted by the coronavirus pandemic and the many challenges it has presented. But despite those challenges, Marie Curie has gone above and beyond to deliver the vital care that they give to people when they need it most. While their work might not always make newspaper headlines or news bulletins, the work of Marie Curie staff means the world to those receiving their care and to the relatives and carers that it gives vital support to. And just one conversation with someone who has seen them in action will tell you that. The Great Daffodil Appeal runs throughout the month of March, and next week, on the 23rd of March, Marie Curie will also be holding a National Day of Reflection, a time to connect for the millions of people who are grieving, to remember the family, friends, neighbours and colleagues who have been lost to us over the past 2 years. And there are lots of ways that you can take part, from joining the minute silence at 12 noon on the 23rd to hosting a wall of reflection wherever you are in your communities. We will be able to come together to remember the mums and dads, daughters, sons, brothers, sisters, cousins and friends who are no longer with us. Presiding Officer, my hope is, in doing a debate like this, that all of my MSP colleagues speaking in the debate or listening along will take the appeal back to their constituencies and regions and further raise awareness of the work of Marie Curie, encouraging more people to volunteer and raise funds so their vital work can continue. And there's a long tradition of us doing that in the Parliament. I want to thank all my colleagues from across the Chamber who supported my motion, and please join me and our party leaders in the Garden Lobby on the Thursday after First Minister's questions for the yearly photo call we haven't had the chance to do for 2 years. And I will be delighted to also host Marie Curie in a Parliament event tomorrow night, and I hope to see members there. Over the years, the need for Marie Curie end-of-life care has increased, and it has meant the world to those who receive it, but the cost of delivering this incredible service is £250,000 per week. The work which Marie Curie does allows people to die with dignity and with comfort in a place such as a care home, hospice or their home. And at the moment, half of people with terminal illness die in hospital. And while both nurses and doctors provide an incredible service in hospital, this can bring challenges for relatives in terms of time and cost of travel to and from the hospital. And by enabling people to have the opportunity to die at home, it means that they're able to be in a place which is familiar and in surroundings which give them comfort and, probably most importantly, with the people they love the most beside them. During the pandemic, Marie Curie have been able to provide end-of-life care at home. And I look in my area of Aberdeenshire. Incredibly, across the whole of NHS Grampian, 54 Marie Curie nurses provided care and made 330 visits to people in Aberdeenshire between 2020 and 2021, whilst working under those most challenging of conditions. 94% of people at the end of their lives who were supported by Marie Curie nurses were able to die in their place of choice, usually at home. And none of this care would have been possible without the generosity of people locally and right across Scotland and the many, many fundraising volunteers. And right now, out in our shopping centres, although I'm looking at the clock and maybe they're all closed, and supermarkets and high streets, you'll see volunteers collecting money from the generous citizens of Scotland to help fund the services of Marie Curie. They're easy to spot, clad in yellow bibs, some with big yellow top hats, you can't miss them. All part of the Great Daffodil Appeal that we're showing our support for by wearing our daffodils this month. And as summer arrives, we'll be preparing to host our Blooming Great Tea Parties, also in support of Marie Curie. But you don't have to wait for these events or to be approached by the yellow-clad volunteers. Many supporters of Marie Curie set up monthly direct debits online, and every penny that you can give helps. Presiding officer, as more people live to an older age, it's estimated by 2040 that 10,000 people every year will need palliative care. And we know that if current trends in where people die continue, that by 2040, two-thirds of all Scots could die at home, in a care home or a hospice. And we know that health inequalities inequities exist, with certain groups of people receiving less palliative care than others with a comparable need. And by supporting all people from across our society with terminal conditions, we can help them, but we can also help to relieve pressures and acute services, including reducing unnecessary hospital admissions, including those through accident and emergency. But I would like to finish, Presiding Officer, with the words of senior Marie Curie nurse Anne-Marie Craig. Anne-Marie works in the NHS Grampian area, and speaking to the Press and Journal at the end of last year, Anne-Marie spoke movingly about how rewarding her role as a Marie Curie nurse can be. And she said, "You do get job satisfaction knowing that you're looking after people at a really difficult time. When somebody has passed away, that's when people make contact with us. People regularly contact me because they want to make a donation, and they always remember the nurse's name. They will specifically say, 'Can you thank Linda or whoever?' because they've been there a long time, in the house for 9 hours, and you get to know them as well as patients." Well, Anne-Marie, I'd like to say to you and all the nurses, staff and volunteers in Marie Curie who go above and beyond each day, and to everyone who donates and allows Anne-Marie and her colleagues to give our loved ones that care, thank you for all that you do. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Martin, and I call on Stephen Kerr, who will be followed by Rhona Mackay for up to 4 minutes. Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's a real honour to be able to participate in this debate on the Marie Curie Great Daffodil Appeal for 2022, and I congratulate Gillian Martin on bringing this debate. It's a very important matter, because like most individuals in this chamber and across the country, I have direct experience of relatives and friends requiring palliative and end-of-life care. In fact, it's one of the very few inevitable things about life for every one of us. And the passing of a loved one is a testing time for all families. The support given by nursing and hospice staff eases the suffering that we face as individuals and families, as well as easing the suffering of those that are facing end of life. But through their dedication to their profession, nursing and hospice staff create space for moments of joy in the last months and weeks of someone's life, and we all need our memories of loved ones. Worryingly, pressures on the social and palliative care sector are increasing, and this is not a new phenomenon, but I would say that it's evidence of the lack of our collective political will to deal with the issues that we are presented with in this sector. And I am minded that perhaps to suggest that we should have some form of legal right to the appropriate palliative and end-of-life treatment. Everyone in this chamber understands the importance of this care. We all, I believe, have a duty as parliamentarians at times to leave behind political manoeuvring and come together to support something that is actually a matter of life and love. And the scale of the challenge we collectively face has been magnified by the COVID-19 pandemic. As Gillian Martin points out in her motion, Marie Curie cared for over 9,000 people in Scotland during 2020-2021, which is reportedly the highest number of patients cared for in a single year since the charity was established 70 years ago. In central Scotland region, we also have the Strathcarran Hospice, which cares for 1,400 people across Forth Valley, Cumbernauld and Kilsyth. This support is only able to be provided because of the generosity of fundraisers and donors. As pointed out in the motion, Marie Curie requires £250,000 a week to deliver its frontline services. Strathcarran Hospice requires £14,315 a day to keep its services running. And the fact that so many people are willing to support this care is inspiring and helps involve all of us in supporting those costs that are there and are real and are incurred as we help each other towards end of life. When we actively play our part in providing funding through lotteries, appeals, raffles, bake sales, coffee mornings and so on, we are actually all part of a great movement. Charities like Marie Curie add love to what they do. The love of those who give, who leave bequests, or who get involved in fundraising efforts. But also, it's about the love of those who provide those services, their devotion and dedication, which is enabled by the voluntary giving of so many thousands of our fellow countrymen and women. I hope that we will all take time on the day of reflection on the 23rd of March this year to remember those whom we have lost and those whom we have loved. I conclude with the very memorable words of Her Majesty the Queen in relation to the issue of grief and mourning. She said, "Grief is the price we pay for love." I think we owe each other an obligation to make sure that as we, each of us in turn, approach the end of life, that the appropriate level of love and care is there. And Marie Curie do that in such a splendid and wonderful way.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Kerr. I now call on Rona Mackay, who joins us remotely, and will be followed by Jackie Bailey for around 4 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be speaking in this debate, and can I thank my colleague Gillian Martin for bringing it to the Chamber. Presiding Officer, over the past 2 years, all of our lives have been turned upside down due to COVID-19. We've been through some terrible, unpredictable times, and in fact, are still going through it as we try to learn to live with the virus. And if it's been bad for us, the frontline medical workers have been heroic, every single one of those dedicated people who work throughout all healthcare areas. Presiding Officer, I've been fortunate to speak in most debates on Marie Curie's Great Daffodil Appeals since being elected in 2016. And in an unpredictable, ever-changing world, Marie Curie's a constant reassurance, like a big comfort blanket, that gives people the knowledge that they or a family member or friend will have choice and dignity in the event of terminal illness. During 2020 to 21, Marie Curie cared for the highest number of patients in Scotland in a single year since it was established 70 years ago, over 9,000 people in Scotland. And that is remarkable, even by Marie Curie's standard, Presiding Officer. But of course, to support these frontline services, the charity needs to raise £250,000 per week to continue the vital care and support that Marie Curie provides across local authorities and hospices. And that's why this appeal is so important. Marie Curie and their amazing army of volunteers offer so much to everyone affected by terminal illness. That means helping families, bereavement support, emotional support, carer support and companionship. And the amazing Marie Curie information and support service is invaluable to patients and their families at their time of need. They offer unconditional support and advice. Nothing is too much trouble. And this horrible virus, as Gillian Martin has said, has brought into focus how necessary access to palliative and dignified end-of-life care is. We're extremely fortunate to have some amazing organisations such as Marie Curie, Macmillan Cancer and others. Presiding Officer, I'm in favour of assisted dying for terminally ill people, but I'm also supportive of palliative care should the person choose that to allow a dignified and peaceful death. It is a very personal decision. I'm delighted to say that there are Marie Curie fundraising groups in my constituency in Bishop Briggs, Kirkintilloch, Glensey and Bearsden, and they're just some of the 85 or so groups in Scotland doing fantastic work. In my last speech, I highlighted research about the issue of too many people who are caring for someone at the end of life going unidentified and unsupported, and that should be addressed. Carers need to be identified early, and it's everyone's responsibility to identify them, not least GPs, social workers and district nurses, and signpost them to Marie Curie so they can at least break, even just for a few hours. Financial support and advice are also vital. The problem is that carers often don't see themselves as carers. They see themselves as mothers, sons, brothers and friends, doing what they do out of love, so don't identify as carers or ask for help, often to the detriment of their own health. But carers should know that Marie Curie is always there to step in and help care for their loved one with tenderness and professionalism. Marie Curie nurses give people with terminal illness choice and dignity. They make it possible for people faced with a terminal illness to have the choice to die peacefully in their own homes, surrounded by the people they love. None of us know when and if we will need the support of Marie Curie nurses, but we should all be eternally grateful that if we do, they will be there. The Great Daffodil Appeal is Marie Curie's biggest annual fundraising campaign. From wearing a daffodil pin to organising large gala dinners or small bake sales, there are countless ways for people to get involved and know that they're contributing to an absolutely wonderful charity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mackay. And I call on Jackie Bailey to be followed by Paul McLennan for around 4 minutes, Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Let me start by congratulating Gillian Martin on securing debating time for this important topic, but also for the content of her speech. Can I also acknowledge the very helpful briefing provided by Marie Curie in advance of the debate? But the indispensable work of Marie Curie and the entirety of the hospice staff team, and indeed the community nurses, especially over the last 2 years, cannot be understated. And I want to record my thanks for all that they have done and that they continue to do. When family members couldn't be with their loved ones, Marie Curie was there. Staff provided dignified and important palliative and end-of-life care, supported those who were dying, supported their families, and they have been the backbone of our communities throughout the pandemic. End-of-life care is as important as any other aspect of our health and social care system, yet it is often overlooked. And as Gillian Martin rightly said, around 50% of people currently die in Scottish hospitals, but the majority would prefer to die at home or in a homely setting. So we must do better to honour their wishes by better supporting our hospices and palliative care nurses delivering services at home. Hospices have faced deep and difficult challenges since the pandemic began, but they have risen to these challenges time and time again. I know that Marie Curie cared for over 9,000 people in Scotland between 2020 and 21, the highest number since the charity was formed 70 years ago. I know it is also true that St Margaret's Hospice in Clydebank, where a number of my constituents are cared for by the indomitable Sister Rita and her dedicated team of staff, coped with similar pressures. The pressures must be immense, and yet hospice staff at both St Margaret's and at Marie Curie hospices continue to provide that care day in and day out. It's estimated that by 2040, across Scotland, over 62,000 people will be dying with palliative care needs each year. In my own constituency, 89.5% of those who pass away each year spend the last 6 months of their life at home or in a community setting. And as the need for palliative care increases, it is crucial that we support hospices to deliver this work. Let me thank Marie Curie volunteers that contribute so much with their fundraising activities, and a special shout out to the Marie Curie shop in Alexandria that I have spent some time in during Volunteers Week each year. So I very much welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to a national clinical lead and a new national palliative care strategy. This will require a whole system public health approach to terminal illness at a national and local level, and it should be introduced, unsurprisingly, in my view, sooner rather than later. The third sector needs to be at the heart of shaping these proposals, and the strategy needs to address concerns around workforce capacity, the coordination of care, sustainable funding, which has been a perennial issue given to community-based palliative care services as a matter of urgency. But we also need to address inequalities within our society that can be found mirrored in palliative care too. Many groups receive less palliative care than others with comparable needs, including those who are over the age of 85, from ethnically diverse backgrounds, from deprived areas in our communities, those living with mental health needs, or those who identify as LGBTQ. They're all less likely to ask for help when they need it, and this must be addressed by any strategy. The trend of increased deaths at home has stayed high, even as the pandemic has become more manageable, which highlights the need, in my view, for well-equipped services and an adequate workforce to manage demand. We must support hospice staff in this work now more than ever. We all wear our yellow daffodil badges with pride, and rightly so. But it is time that we put that pride into action and ensure Marie Curie and hospices across the country are supported to continue delivering the world-class care that people across Scotland need and deserve. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Bailey. And I call on Paul McLennan, who will be followed by Gillian Mackay for around 4 minutes. Mr McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Gillian Martin for bringing this debate this evening? Can I also thank Ellie Wagstaff and the team at Marie Curie for their briefing tonight. Marie Curie provides a nursing service in 31 out of 32 of our local authorities. They're also the third largest provider of palliative care for adults in Scotland. And I've seen in action there the helper service, and that provides companionship and support to those affected by terminal illness. And that is a presence in all 32 for local authorities. They also have their information and support lines, and that includes the dedicated bereavement line, which provides that key emotional support for families during a really difficult time. It's been mentioned before that in 2020 to 2021, Marie Curie supported over 9,000 people living with a terminal illness, and it's been mentioned that that's the highest number ever. The key thing I think you obviously see as well in the working partnership with the NHS and also local authorities and other charities in delivering the services that provide that care. In East Lothian, on average, around about 1,150 people die each year. About 1,000 of these people are people who have palliative care need. And last year, 312 visits were made by Marie Curie in my constituency. 88% of those spent the last 6 months of life at home or in a community setting. And the pandemic also showed a 43% increase in deaths at home, and I think that's likely to see that continuing trend. So it's important we look at the future demands on palliative care services as our populations age. And I think what we're also seeing now is people living into older age, and we've got multiple conditions and the number of deaths going up. Marie Curie are estimating around about 10,000 needing palliative care by 2040. And they obviously mentioned around about the opportunity without substantial investment in community-based care. They see the hospital deaths could increase to around about 57% of all deaths by 2040. COVID-19, I think, has provided insight into what increased demand for palliative support in the community could look like. And we mentioned around about the 6,000 more Scottish deaths at home than in previous years, and that trend obviously is likely to continue. I think one of the key things that Marie Curie mentioned in her briefing as well is around about the challenges of workforce capacity, care coordination, and integration between health and social care, and sustainable funding for community palliative care services. I think that's a challenge to us all. And I appreciate, obviously, if the Minister could touch on these issues in the summing up as well. Thank you, Jackie.
Can I take an intervention?
If I can get the time. Yeah.
You can get the time back. Yeah. Finlay Carson.
Thank you for taking my intervention. Would you join me in recognising the dedication of Marie Curie workers and volunteers right across the country, but particularly in rural areas where they support dying people and their families, and recognise that in rural areas the challenges of providing palliative care have never been greater, and Marie Curie have really stepped up to the mark in supporting people no matter where they live.
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, I fully support that. I mean, I don't have as rural a constituency as Mr Carson, but we do have some rural areas in my constituency, and that is a challenge, and I know the support they give, so yeah, fully support that. So I think the Scottish Government is committed to a national clinical lead in new palliative care strategy, and I think that's much welcomed. Marie Curie indeed welcomed that. They said it obviously requires a whole system public health approach to terminal illness, and that should be adopted. And I think this is a key thing that Mr Carson mentioned, both nationally and locally, taking in local circumstances. Marie Curie in the briefing also asked that the strategy sets out a plan for palliative care delivery in all settings, and that includes in hospitals, hospices, care homes, and of course people's own homes. And again, that's taken in, I think, local indications. They also state that this must include bereavement support, which I think is incredibly important for families. They need to work with all care providers, including the NHS, social care, independent and third sectors, to work towards ending palliative care inequalities and inequities amongst groups which struggle to access vital palliative care services. The other thing they're calling for is establishing a new national palliative and end-of-life care network, linking key stakeholders with health boards and other integration authorities. Marie Curie also supports, and I think, the establishment of the National Care Service, but it states it must be a framework for palliative care to flourish, to support terminal ill people to have an end-of-life experience which reflects what is most important to them. And they also mentioned that this needs a whole system public health approach, which will be crucial for the design and delivery of the National Care Service at that particular stage. The third sector must also be at the heart of informing the National Care Service's design and structure, given the key role it plays in integrated service. Presiding Officer, can I conclude by thanking Marie Curie for their amazing care that they have given so many families over the years in what is a really difficult time. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Mr McLennan. I now call on Gillian Mackay, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Emma Harper for around 4 minutes, Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
I too would like to extend my thanks to everyone caring for people at the end of their life throughout the pandemic and beyond. Anyone who's witnessed Marie Curie nurses caring for a loved one in the last days and weeks of their life will be keenly aware of the incredible work they do. They work to give people a good death, and they provide kindness, care and compassion for people and their families who are going through the unimaginable. I've heard from constituents about the incredible support they've provided to them and their family members, and how they did everything possible that they could to make the most difficult experience in their lives a little less painful. I'd also like to take the opportunity to associate myself with the remarks Stephen Kerr has made about Strathcarran Hospice in our Central Scotland region. They do some amazing work locally and have a wide range of support from people and businesses across the area. The pandemic has led to more open conversations about what a good death looks like and how we can afford people dignity in death. We must keep these discussions going as we enter recovery. Scotland's ageing population means more and more people will be dying in the years to come. With Marie Curie research suggesting up to 10,000 more people dying every year with palliative care needs by 2040. People will also be more likely to die in the community, either in their own homes or in residential care homes. We should enable people to have the death that they want, one that reflects their wishes, and palliative care will play an essential role in that. Many people dying at home will also be cared for by family and friends, and it's vital that they get the right support, both while they're in their caring role and after their loved one has died. Marie Curie estimate that every year around 40,000 to 50,000 carers in Scotland are bereaved. We must ensure they can access dedicated mental health support when they need it. Often people can be left not knowing where to turn after the death of a loved one, not knowing who can help them to process their grief. We must be proactive about identifying carers who have been bereaved and signposting them to support, such as that provided by Marie Curie's Bereavement Support Service. We must also improve our ability to proactively identify people with palliative care needs at an early stage. There is currently significant unmet need, as one third of Scots with terminal conditions die without an anticipatory care plan in place. Marie Curie have pointed out that the inverse care law applies to palliative care just as it does to other parts of the health and care system, and significant inequalities exist. People from minority ethnic backgrounds and from rural and deprived communities are less likely to receive palliative care. They are also less likely to ask for it. Research conducted by Marie Curie has revealed that many people from ethnically diverse groups are not accessing palliative care, and when they do, palliative care delivery is not always sensitive to their different needs, particularly around culture and religion. Research has also shown that one in six LGBTQ plus people are discriminated against when using public services such as palliative care, and half of LGBTQ plus people expect to be discriminated against. This can discourage them from accessing the care services they need. There are also misconceptions about who is entitled to palliative care, such as that it is only for people with cancer, and this must be challenged. We need to improve awareness of what palliative care is available and how it can be accessed, but we also need to ensure palliative care services are person-centred, culturally competent, and that they have the resources they need to identify and engage with people who are terminally ill. I'd like to conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, by thanking Gillian Martin for bringing this debate forward, by again thanking everyone working at Marie Curie. As the motion states, Marie Curie needs £250,000 per week to support its frontline services, which is why it's so important that we take time to highlight the great daffodil appeal in Parliament and encourage people to support it however they can.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay. And I call the final speaker in the open debate, Emma Harper, for around 4 minutes. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wasn't planning on speaking, but I have contributed in previous years, and I wanted to support my colleague Gillian Martin and be in chamber here when she was leading the debate. So I do thank Gillian Martin for leading this debate this year. And I remember as a new MSP, Bruce Crawford leading this previously when I was a newbie. And In my own career as a registered nurse, I have looked after terminally ill people, and that was in the perioperative or the peri-anaesthesia environment, but not actually directly with end-of-life care. And I also was able to look after people in a ward setting as well. And when I was a clinical educator in NHS Dumfries and Galloway, I worked with the team in the Alexandra unit at DGRI in Dalrymple Ward at Galloway Community Hospital, where end-of-life and pain management care is provided by an absolutely amazing team. And I want to thank you all, because you are awesome. And, you know, I also want to thank the Marie Curie staff and the nurses and the carers and the volunteers, because without you, we couldn't raise the funds that we needed in order to take this forward. You're all fantastic, and I don't think I could do what they do every day. I want to also recognise that the briefing that Ellie Wagstaff sent us from Marie Curie ahead of this debate, it talks about the £250,000 per week that's needed to support frontline services. And Stephen Kerr mentioned the £14,000 for the one in his area. And that is really, really highlights how it does require investment in the services in order to provide the best person-centred end-of-life and palliative care that Gillian Mackay was mentioning in her remarks. And it is interesting to hear about everybody else's contributions. And I know that, as Paul McLennan says, 31 out of 32 local authorities have Marie Curie services. And I welcome the Great Daffodil Appeal and the reception that is going to take place on Wednesday, the 16th of March, here in Holyrood. And there will be speakers that will obviously reflect on their experience and their, personal experience as well, which I'm sure will be very valuable for us all to hear. So just as I wasn't planning on speaking, I want to just congratulate Gillian Martin again, thank her for leading this debate this year, and I look forward to hearing the Minister's response, and once again thank all the volunteers that are out there fundraising for this Great Daffodil Appeal this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. I now call on the Minister to respond to the debate. Ms Todd, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you. And first of all, on behalf of the Scottish Government, I want to also welcome this year's Great Daffodil Appeal and to thank Gillian Martin for bringing the motion to the Chamber this afternoon, or this evening, in fact. The past 2 years have been so difficult for all of us in so many ways, and I know that it has been a particularly difficult time for those working in the third sector. And that's why I'm absolutely delighted to be here this evening to celebrate Marie Curie's Great Daffodil Appeal and to have the opportunity to thank all of the Marie Curie staff who have worked tirelessly and selflessly over the past few years. The contributions of Marie Curie to the well-being of those near the end of life and those around them is quite simply invaluable. We've heard here today from other members just how much Marie Curie services mean to people right across Scotland and the difference they make to local communities. And I know that Marie Curie have made, even in the last challenging year, over 1,000 visits to people in my area in NHS Highland, and I thank them for that. I want to take a moment to thank all of those across Scotland whose generous donations have helped to make Marie Curie Great Daffodil Appeal such a great success since it began in 1986. The donations are so important to ensure that Marie Curie can continue to provide vital support and provide the high quality, person-centred care we all associate with Marie Curie. Death, dying and bereavement and preparing for the end of life isn't a subject that is often discussed openly. The pandemic has shone a spotlight on the importance of having these conversations early and meaningfully to help to ensure that people get the care that is right for them. The Scottish Government has long been committed to drive a culture of openness about death, dying and bereavement. It was one of the key actions set out in a previous strategic framework for action on palliative and end-of-life care in 2015. Throughout the pandemic, we've continued our work with organisations such as Marie Curie and the Scottish Partnership for Palliative Care to help to ensure that people and their families are supported to have these difficult discussions so that people can receive the care that's right for them. As Marie Curie have rightly pointed out, the demand for such services will only continue to grow. And that's why it's so important for us to take time to reflect on the work we've done to date and to think about what we can do better. Scotland is a world leader in the field of palliative and end-of-life care, and I'm really proud of the improvements that have been made since we published our last strategy. That includes increasing the number of people who have key information summary in place, increasing the availability and spread of palliative care services, and undertaking an innovative programme of health and social care integration, of which palliative care was a key component. However, we have come a long way since the framework was published, and there is still much more that can be done to make Scotland a place where everyone has access to high-quality, compassionate and timely palliative and end-of-life care that's tailored to their circumstances. And that's why in our programme for government, we committed to developing a new palliative care strategy and appointing a new palliative care lead clinician to help to lead this work. The preparatory work to develop the strategy is already well underway, and the process to appoint a lead clinician has concluded. And I look forward to sharing more details of that appointment with Parliament in the near future. In developing this strategy, we want to learn from the innovative and adaptive work of Marie Curie and the wider palliative and end-of-life care community, in order to develop a pragmatic and meaningful framework for further improving our palliative and end-of-life care services. It's really important to me, and others have also mentioned it, that this new palliative and end-of-life care strategy takes a whole system public health approach to helping to ensure that everyone who needs palliative and end-of-life care can access it, regardless of geographical location, regardless of age, and regardless of medical condition. And that's why, as part of our work to develop a new strategy, we'll be focusing on key areas which can make a real difference to a person's experience towards the end of life. These key areas include data collection and usage, anticipatory care planning, commissioning, planning of services, children's palliative care, to name a few. However, it has only been by working closely together with key stakeholders such as Marie Curie that we have been able to make such progress in taking forward our previous strategy. Marie Curie are already working in partnership with others, including the NHS, local authorities and other charities, to deliver integrated services that provide person-centred care. And I am absolutely confident that with organisations such as Marie Curie, as part of our palliative care community, we will be able to progress further work to ensure that people and their families get the right care for them when they need it most. Deputy Presiding Officer, colleagues, let me finish today's debate by turning your attention to the symbol of today's event, a daffodil flower, which symbolises new beginnings and rebirth. I was really interested to find out that it can also symbolise creativity, inspiration and reflection. Today's event is an excellent opportunity for us to reflect on the creative work undertaken by Marie Curie and the palliative end-of-life care community to support people and their families at the end of life and to celebrate that work. I'm truly inspired by Marie Curie's continuous work for a better end of life for all. I welcome their efforts in raising and maintaining awareness of the topic through events such as this, and I'm very proud to support the Great Daffodil Appeal. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.